next presentation is going to be by Dr. Mountasser Al-Mugdad. It's a study on the outcome of prolonged empirical antibiotics among premature infants.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you to give me opportunity to talk about my project. So title of my study is a study on the outcome of prolonged empirical antibiotics among premature infants. So as we know, antibiotics are the most common medication prescribed in the NICU. And the majority of very premature babies receive antibiotics on admission. Also, the incidence of early onset of sepsis is very low. And as we know, prolonged antibiotic change the colonization of the GI tract. So it is easy to start antibiotics, but it is not easy to decide when we have to stop the antibiotics and for how long. So still the arbitrary use of antibiotics is a dilemma, is a problem, and we couldn't fix it so far. So objective of my study is to investigate the relationship between prolonged initial empirical antibiotic treatment with late onset of sepsis, necrotizing enterocolitis, and death. My study is a retrospective study enrolled in King Saud Medical City, Riyadh, tertiary center. And we started in April 2016 till February 2017. Number of admissions in that time is 5,120 babies. Total of low birth weight was 646. Total number of very low birth weight was 280. Enrolled 216 babies after we exclude the patients who have early onset of sepsis, died or transferred in 5 days of life. So we enrolled the patients, the premature infants who birth weight less or equal 1,500 gram and or gestational age less than or equal 32 weeks. As I said, we excluded the babies who had early onset of sepsis, transferred or died in first five days of life. The primary outcome was the composite of late onset of sepsis, neck or death after the fifth day of life till time of discharge. Of course, definition of late onset of sepsis will be the blood culture positive and neck stage 2 and above. We talk about results. First, about the infant characteristics. We have like 216 babies, I said, 175, around 80% of that babies receive more than 5 days antibiotic, and 41 babies who receive less than or equal 5 days of antibiotic, it is empirical antibiotics. So if we look at it simply, we can find that most of the parameter infant characteristic are more significant in the babies who receive antibiotics more than 5 days, except cord BH and the non-invasive support for RDS. If we talk about the maternal parameters, mostly it is the same between both groups, except the gestational age was more younger in the babies who receive antibiotics more than 5 days. If we look at the PROM, chorioamnionitis, IUGR hypertension, it is almost the same and no statistical significant difference between both the groups. When we come at neck as outcome, we found in the babies who receive antibiotics less than or equal 5 days, we have three babies present with neck. And 38 babies didn't develop neck. And for a group who receive antibiotics more than 5 days, we have around 85, which is around 48% developed neck and 90 babies or 51% didn't develop NIC. And p-value is so much significant. Late onset of sepsis. Babies who receive antibiotics less than or equal 5 days, they develop 0% late onset of sepsis. But the babies who receive antibiotics more than 5 days, they developed 9%. 9% of them, they developed a late onset of sepsis. And p-value also is significant. If we talk about mortality, who received less than or equal five days antibiotic, three babies were died. And who received more than 5 days antibiotics, we have 29 babies, like 16% died. P-value is not significant. If we take all of them as a composite outcome, so we have the p-value is so much significant. So babies who receive antibiotics less than or equal 5 days, five of them present with this outcome, and around 157% receive outcome for babies who receive antibiotics more than 5 days. And because I said the sicker baby received longer antibiotics, it is we have to do the logistic regression to make sure to get the more correct results. And it is very interesting here if we look at first point about the composite outcome, NIC, late onset of sepsis or death after day of life five. If we take about first point, initial empirical antibiotics duration per day, so who receive antibiotic more than five, like each day, 1 day after the 5 day, if beyond 5 days, the odd of he developed this outcome increased by 1.6. And who receive antibiotics more than 5 days, the odd will be increased by 3.4. And for malafid, as we know, it is a risk factor for NIC. It has to be included here in the logistic regression, and the risk will be increased by 3.7. If we talk about late onset of sepsis after day five of life, again, any day after the five of day, the odd of be increased 1.5 for the late onset of sepsis, and the babies who receive antibiotics more than 5 days, the odd will be increased by 1.8. NIC alone after day five. So like 1 day after 5 days, the odd will be increased by 1.7. And if the who receive more than 5 days, the odd will be 3. And formula feed is significantly increasing the risk of NIC. It is 4.3. The odd increased by 4.3. And all of them, p-value, are significant. We try to include all the risk factors for this outcome to minimize the bias. So as a conclusion of my study, prolonged initial empirical antibiotics increase the risk of NIC, late onset of sepsis or death. Of course, limitation of my study, it is a retrospective study and it is a small sample size, but it's still running. And after 4,000 years of antibiotics, we have to be aware more about the side effect, about the sequelae of the prolonged antibiotics. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sijjad.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Mountasser. I think it's important to start the antibiotics at the right time, but it is equally important to know when to stop the antibiotics. Yeah. So what was the definition of prolonged empiric antibiotic which you were using in your unit? And so what is the normal criteria? When do you decide to stop the antibiotics?
So I put the cutoff here is 5 days because the final result of the first blood culture will come after 5 days. So it was for 5 days. But as initial result will be at 48 hours of age, so we'll get the initial result.
So, yeah, but usually we get the result within 48 to 72 hours, and you can make a decision in 72 hours whether to continue or not to continue with the antibiotics.
Yeah. So,
and the second thing is, do you use anything like CRP or procalcitonin as a criteria to supplement your evaluation of when to stop the antibiotics?
Yeah, CRP is good when it is positive, but it is negative. We cannot judge. We have to discontinue. It can make our decision is strong when it is negative, and the clinical sign will correlate with that. The baby is well, stable, no other issues. Again, it is very difficult to decide when I have to stop antibiotics. The message here from my study is I don't mean we have to stop antibiotics once we get negative results after 48 hours. But we have to be individually, for every baby, we have to decide when we have to stop the antibiotics. Because the arbitrary use of antibiotics is, as we saw, it is not good.
But you can look at the whole picture in a way that the babies who did not require more than 5 days antibiotics were probably less sick, and they didn't need antibiotics. So that's why they did not have more deaths or more complications, and the ones who were requiring antibiotics were more sick, and that's why they had a worse outcome as compared to the other group.
So for the study, of course, is a very good, and the message is well related, but you need to put more effort in convincing, when you're writing a paper, in convincing the reader that the one who received more than 5 days and the one who received only 5 days, they were similar at the start. It's not like you gave more 5 days. It was only the attending decision who decided. For example, the rate of chorioamnionitis, the CRP level, WBCs, band count. So we need to have a baseline in the ones who received prolonged, and the one who did not receive prolonged, they were very similar regarding the cell count, the CRP, the chorioamnionitis, everything. That's the whole idea. Regarding, if I have one comment to you, will be related to the slide arrangement. So there is a rule of seven. When you are really presenting in a big place like here, they should not have a slide more than 7 lines, and the line should not have more than 7 words. So horizontally will be 7 words max, and downward 7 lines. Once you start to give more word and more line, you start to get very hard for people to read. But it, definitely the topic is very well, excellent. Thank you.
Dr. Zakaria.
Thank you, Mountasser, for this tremendous effort. I'm sure you have spent the nights in the NICU trying to gather data. I have one comment and a small comment and one question, because maybe I missed it in your presentation. I'm worried again about your conclusion. You said there is increased risk. You did a retrospective study and you did all odds ratio. You did not use risk ratios because of the nature of the study. So I don't think we should have concluded saying increased risk. It should have been said it was associated with. Now the question is, and probably I missed it, you mentioned there the average duration of antibiotics in the group that receive antibiotics more than 5 days is 3 days. Did I get it incorrectly, or in one of the slides you were saying?
No.
I missed it.
It's equal 5 days and above 5 days.
Yeah.
I didn't say 3.
No, at the bottom of the slide, the duration of antibiotics, it's 1 day versus 3 days.
No.
In the first slide of the results.
If you want, you can back. Course. You mean course?
Yeah. Number of courses?
Number of course, I think.
Can you
course of antibiotics, not days.
Which?
Course. Course 48 hours.
Can you explain to me, because I'm sorry, I'm
days not... of days on antibiotic, mm-hmm. different from courses. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we put in course, mm-hmm. at least 48 hours to 7 days. Mm-hmm. So this is course. The definition will be course, but yeah. The days is different.
Yeah. Okay. If I'm allowed to add one more thing, is it okay? There is already a study that looked at that, right? And the way I look at it personally is that if there is already a study that doesn't need replication again, it would have been better if you started actually implementing that evidence if you are convinced, rather than to spend more time trying to prove what has been proven. Maybe if you put guidelines about the usage of antibiotics and how we can improve the usage, it would have been better. This is my personal opinion.
Yeah, nice. I like this this comment, because what I found is, although we have many publications about this issue, we still we have difficult to decide when we have to stop antibiotics. I decided to start from to create phase one, to know exactly what we have, to decide what is the action, like antibiotic stewardship program. I want to create it. I want data to know, okay, we have to jump to the phase two to compare what we have and what we get it. So I think it still valid to do this study, at least in my site, to know what I have to do.
Yeah. But when it comes to publication, so I think the point is well taken. So it's very good to start writing the paper, but just in case, which is very possible, when it doesn't get accepted,
I know.
You already started the second phase. And people generally, when you are submitting a paper, people generally like the contrast. So you say, we did this study in two phases. Phase one, we did a retrospective part and we looked at, which is this part. Then we decided to start phase two. So prospectively, from now on, we decided not to give any antibiotic beyond 3 days, except if, and you put very specific criteria, if the WBCs was what, or CRP was what, or blood culture was what. And then you do only 1 year of that upcoming prospective. By the time you finish writing the first paper, then you have the data for the second paper ready to go.
Yeah, I think you need to be precise in the definition. You have to use the standard definition. To me, 5 days is still prolonged, and I think this is, this you will find it in the literature. Usually 48 to 72 hours you get the results. So you cannot just change the, I mean, the definition just because you don't get the culture. So you have to put effort to bring the culture reports earlier rather than extending and redefining what is defined already.
Yeah, you are right, but we have good number of cases around of my small career. Babies who get negative culture at 48, 72 hours, and we get the final result, after 5 days the culture was changed to positive culture. So here we have to be careful when we say what is the sensitivity of the first culture at 48, 72 hours. If it is negative, so that means that the final result will be after like 5 days will be negative. So this is my point why I select 5 days.
But data, there are already data existing. I thought there are, you have a logistic problem that the lab does not give you the report until day five. But there are already data saying 48-hour culture sensitivity is 90% and 72-hour sensitivity is like 99%. Or I think 95 and 99. So by 72 hours, if the culture is still negative, the odd for the culture to come positive after 72 hours is less than 1%. But maybe some labs takes time to give you a report that's something different.
Okay. Any questions from female side?
No question.